Imagine living in a world where a scratch from a rose thorn, a sore throat, or a tooth infection could kill you. For most of human history, this was reality. In the early 20th century, diseases like pneumonia, tuberculosis, scarlet fever, and septicemia were among the top causes of death. Soldiers often survived bullets in the trenches of World War I, only to die from infected wounds. Women giving birth risked fatal infections. Even children could die from a small cut that turned septic. Then, by pure chance, a forgotten Petri dish containing a bit of mold changed everything. This accidental discovery opened the door to the antibiotic era and transformed medicine forever. This is the story of penicillin, the mold that saved millions and reshaped the modern world. Before antibiotics, doctors and healers had few tools against infection. Ancient physicians noticed that certain molds could help heal festering wounds. The Edwin Smith Papyrus, dated to the 15th century BCE and attributed to the Egyptian physician Imhotep, described using moldy substances on injuries. Hippocrates in Greece and Avicenna in the Islamic world also recommended applying mold poultices to purulent wounds. These treatments were based on observation rather than science, but they hinted at nature's hidden power. By the late 19th century, medicine was advancing rapidly, anesthesia, antisepsis, and vaccines had appeared. But bacterial infections still killed millions. Doctors often prescribed toxic substances like mercury, arsenic, or silver compounds. They sometimes helped, but often poisoned the patient as well. World War was especially devastating. Nearly half of battlefield deaths were due not to bullets or bombs, but to infections that followed. Soldiers with shrapnel or gunshot wounds frequently succumbed to sepsis, and doctors had no effective cure. Humanity stood on the edge of scientific progress but still lacked the one weapon it needed most, a safe, reliable way to kill bacteria inside the body. In September 1928, Alexander Fleming made an observation that would later become famous. Returning to his bench at St. Mary's Hospital in London after a holiday, he noticed that a Petri dish containing a culture of Staphylococcus aureus had been contaminated by a blue-green mold. Around the mold, there was a clear zone of inhibition, an area where the bacteria simply would not grow. Fleming identified the contaminant as a Penicillin species and carried out simple tests that showed the mold secreted an antibacterial substance. He called it penicillin. Fleming published his initial account in 1929 in the British Journal of Experimental Pathology. In that paper, he described how penicillin inhibited the growth of Staphylococci, Streptococci, and Pneumococci in vitro. Some studies have noted limited activity against anthrax and diphtheria bacteria, whereas other organisms, especially Escherichia coli and the cholera vibrio, did not respond to the drug. Fleming speculated about clinical uses, but faced severe technical obstacles. Crude extracts were unstable, and the active substance was produced only in tiny quantities. Importantly, Fleming warned about the potential for resistance if subtherapeutic doses were used. He noticed that bacteria exposed to low concentrations could produce survivors with reduced sensitivity. Despite this cautionary note, the discovery did not immediately alter medical practice. The scientific community treated penicillin mainly as an interesting laboratory phenomenon, promising but impractical, and the breakthrough waited for new minds and new methods to bring it into clinical reality. For nearly a decade after Fleming's paper, penicillin remained a laboratory oddity. The problem was practical. Penicillin produced only trace amounts, crude preparations decomposed quickly, and there were no reliable methods for purification or large-scale production. Meanwhile, other antibacterial discoveries, sulfonamides like prontosil, actinomycin derivatives, and tyrothresin, attracted attention and resources. Penicillin's promise was clear, but turning it into a reliable medicine required new techniques. The decisive work began in Oxford under Howard Florey and Ernst Chain. This Oxford group combined clinical perspective, biochemical expertise, and inventive laboratory engineering. Norman Heatley, a young chemist in the team, developed methods to concentrate penicillin from enormous volumes of fungal broth. At first, the team used diethyl ether as an extracting solvent, allowed later they switched to amyl acetate because it provided better yields and more stable extracts. They then established reproducible biological assays. Laboratory animals were infected with virulent strains of Staphylococci and Streptococci, and treated animals reliably survived while controls died. In 1940, the Oxford group succeeded in isolating a crystalline form of penicillin and in standardizing assays of potency. The activity of the Oxford preparation was orders of magnitude greater than Fleming's original crude extracts. The difference was not incremental, it was transformative. Penicillin had become a quantifiable drug, suitable for clinical testing. The remaining hurdle was scale. producing enough penicillin for hospitals and battlefields would require industrial fermentation, purification engineering, and partnerships with pharmaceutical companies. In 1941, Florian Heatley traveled to the United States to seek industrial partners. They found allies in the U.S. Department of Agriculture's laboratories at Peoria, Illinois, which specialized in fermentation research. There, scientists began screening hundreds of mold strains and experimented with corn steep liquor, a byproduct of corn processing, as a nutrient medium. This dramatically increased yields. Pharmaceutical companies quickly joined. Pfizer pioneered deep tank fermentation, solving the problem of producing penicillin in liquid culture on an industrial scale. Merck developed purification processes that allowed penicillin to be stabilized and crystallized. Squibb and Eli Lilly also contributed, each bringing expertise in chemical engineering and large-scale production. By 1943, production was accelerating. Penicillin was prioritized as a war drug, with the US and British governments coordinating resources. By the time of the D-Day landings in June 1944, Allied forces carried millions of doses. For soldiers with infected wounds, penicillin was nothing short of miraculous. Survival rates soared, amputations dropped, and septicemia, once a near-certain killer, could be cured. In the press, penicillin was celebrated as a secret weapon. French newspapers later wrote, "For the defeat of fascism and the liberation of France, Alexander Fleming has done more than entire divisions." It was not just a scientific breakthrough, it became part of the mythology of victory. After the war ended, penicillin did not fade into obscurity. Instead, it became a household name, a symbol of modern science's triumph over infection. In 1945, Alexander Fleming, Howard Florey, and Ernst Chain were jointly awarded the Nobel Prize in Physiology or Medicine. During his Nobel lecture, Fleming delivered a prophetic warning: bacteria could eventually become resistant to penicillin if the drug was used carelessly. His words, largely overlooked at the time, would later prove hauntingly accurate. By the late 1940s, penicillin production expanded worldwide. American companies like Merck, Pfizer, and Squibb scaled up manufacturing, while British laboratories contributed knowledge. The drug spectrum was well documented, highly effective against Staphylococcus, Streptococcus, and Pneumococcus, for pneumonia, syphilis, gonorrhea, wound infections, and septicemia. Penicillin was revolutionary. Doctors and patients alike hailed it as a miracle drug. Mortality from bacterial pneumonia dropped dramatically. Surgeries became safer. Minor wounds no longer carried the same threat of fatal infection. But in science, no discovery stands alone. The very triumph of penicillin inspired an intense global race to find other antibiotics. In 1935, even before Fleming's discovery was recognized, Gerhard Domack in Germany introduced Prontosil, the first commercially available sulfa drug. Soon after, in the United States, microbiologist René Dubos isolated tyrosin from soil bacteria, and researchers realized that nature itself was full of antibiotic producers. The golden age of antibiotics had begun. By the 1950s and 1960s, new classes appeared almost every year: streptomycin, tetracyclines, macrolides, cephalosporins. Doctors finally had weapons against tuberculosis, pneumonia, and dozens of once lethal infections. Companies like Pfizer, Merck, and Eli Lilly grew into pharmaceutical giants on the back of antibiotic research. Yet almost immediately, another problem emerged: resistance. Bacteria are not static targets, they evolve. As early as the 1940s, doctors reported Staphylococcus aureus strains that no longer responded to penicillin. By the 1960s, resistant gonorrhea and pneumococcus were spreading. Each new antibiotic brought only temporary victory before microbes adapted. Penicillin itself remained widely used, especially against streptococcal infections and syphilis, but it was no longer the universal miracle it seemed during World War II. Hospitals learned that no antibiotic was eternal, and the arms race with bacteria had only begun. Penicillin remains a foundational drug in modern medicine, though its role has evolved significantly since the 1940s. Once hailed as a universal remedy against bacterial infections, penicillin today is used selectively where its pharmacology and antibacterial spectrum match the clinical need. The classic natural and early semi-synthetic forms, penicillin G and penicillin V, are still first-line treatments for streptococcal pharyngitis, rheumatic fever prophylaxis, some cases of bacterial endocarditis, and selected obstetric and neonatal infections. Over the decades, the penicillin family expanded into numerous derivatives: ampicillin, amoxicillin, flucloxacillin, and others, and clinicians developed combinations with beta-lactamase inhibitors. These innovations widened the effective spectrum to include many gram-negative organisms and restored activity against bacteria that produce penicillinases. There are practical reasons why classical penicillins are no longer universal. Allergic reactions are the most visible danger, and immediate IgE-mediated response can trigger anaphylaxis. This risk has changed prescribing habits and promoted alternative agents where allergy is suspected. Antibiotic resistance has been the greater challenge. Bacteria evolved penicillinases, altered target proteins, and acquired efflux mechanisms and porin mutations that reduce drug entry. Side effects go beyond allergy. Broad antibiotic use perturbs the gut microbiome, sometimes precipitating Clostridioides difficile infection and long-term dysbiosis. Nevertheless, penicillin's strengths endure: low cost, proven efficacy for susceptible organisms, and well-characterized safety for most patients. In many low- or middle-income countries, penicillin remains an essential, life-saving medicine. Rapid diagnostic tests, susceptibility panels, and improved laboratory workflows make it easier today to choose penicillin precisely in surgical prophylaxis and selected community infections. It still saves lives. Penicillin's legacy is both scientific and social. During World War II, the Oxford team refused to patent the drug, believing it should be available to everyone. This decision allowed rapid mass production and saved millions of lives. As penicillin spread, so did resistant bacteria. To fight this, governments banned over-the-counter sales, hospitals created antibiotic stewardship programs, and the World Health Organization began coordinating global surveillance of resistance. But the problem of fairness remained. Cheap antibiotics lowered death rates in poor countries, yet uncontrolled use accelerated resistance worldwide. Expanding access saves lives, but without careful control, it makes the drugs less effective for everyone. The lessons are clear. We need new ways to fund antibiotic research, better diagnostics, and policies that link human, animal, and environmental health. Above all, penicillin reminds us that antibiotics are a shared global resource. Preserving their power requires cooperation, responsible prescribing, and ongoing innovation.